Good evening, everybody. My name is Margaret and I lead the clinical services here at the hospice. I just want to firstly let you know about a little change in the programme. Sophie Cochran, our singer, is unable to be here, and that's due to a family bereavement. So I know that she'll be in all our thoughts tonight as we go through this event. It's an absolute privilege to extend a very warm welcome to each and every one of you as we come together on this evening of Thanksgiving and remembrance. It's an opportunity to not only remember those that we care about who have died, but also to give thanks for their lives. Grief is our natural response to loss. Grieving is learning to live without the person who has died, and that is hard. The pain of grief cannot be compared. Everyone's loss is different and everyone's grief is different. Grief takes time to adjust to a world from which the person you love is now absent. It is normal to have good and bad days, and grief may be triggered by certain memories or events. The person who has died is still important in your life. Allow yourself to grieve. You may find strength within yourself that you didn't know you had. Acknowledge the grief. Seek help and strength to journey through it. Take things one step at a time. Cherish the memories and know that healing takes time.
Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us.
I'd like to introduce you to Lorna McCafferty now. She's from our fundraising team and she'll read a poem, Love is But a Stopping Place.
Life is but a stopping place, a pause in what's to be, a resting place along the road to sweet eternity. We all have different journeys, different paths along the way. We are all meant to learn some things, but never meant to stay. Our destination is a place far greater than we know. For some the journey's quicker, for some the journey's slow. And when the journey finally ends, we'll claim a great reward and find an everlasting peace together with the Lord.
For those of you who don't know her already, I'd like to introduce Caroline Gordon, who's our chaplain here at the hospice, and she's going to guide us through a reflection, A Time to Remember.
Good evening, everybody. So nice to see you all. Lots of familiar faces. I really want to welcome everybody, including those that are watching on live stream. You're all welcome, sincerely. I always feel a great weight of responsibility whenever I'm preparing for these services. Somehow this one seemed to weigh quite heavy and I really wasn't quite able to come and make peace with what I wanted to say. And I think if I'm honest, I felt inadequate. Each one of you has suffered the soul-wrenching loss of somebody you loved. Each one of you has endured the unendurable. And you may even be feeling tonight like you can't endure anymore. This service is for everyone. No matter what words I say, or even more importantly, what I don't say, your grief and your experience of loss is important and it's valid. Words will never be able to adequately express the depth of feeling that is among us all tonight. And how easy is it that society uses words like remembrance as if we need any reminding of the vacuum in our hearts that our loved ones leave? How difficult is it to be thankful sometimes in the depths of our grief? But how comforting to know that we're not alone. And together, as we all participate in this service of thanksgiving, remembrance, and love. And with gratitude in our hearts, maybe we'll feel just a wee bit of relief tonight. Our spirits might just have that tiny bit more understanding. Every one of us who's joined here tonight has come for a reason. Maybe it's because the hospice is a place that connects you to your loved one. Perhaps it's because you feel thankful. Maybe you came because you feel lonely and in your grief misunderstood. Perhaps you came because the pain you're feeling is so raw and so great that you felt you had nothing to lose. What really matters, as my lovely colleague Joel said to me yesterday, is that you came. You got here, you made it. Each of you with your own very individual stories of loss, but all of you united by the collective act of remembering that person that you loved. You'll need to forgive me, I need to be careful because it's windy. I think all of us hope that we will find some comfort, a feeling of peace, maybe. I really hope a sense of togetherness. Our prayer for this evening is to bring to all of you just a bit more understanding and a whole lot of heartfelt, and I mean that sincerely, heartfelt love. My reflections on my own are limited. I only have my experience. And so actually I decided to reach out to some of my friends and family and acquaintances and I asked them to share with me their feelings and experiences about grief. I have to be honest, I was deeply moved. Nothing that was said to me was new or surprising, but the way it was said really touched my soul. So with kind permission from all of them, much of my words tonight are influenced by the things that they said to me. Grief, loss, bereavement, it's one of the few certainties of life. You know that old saying about death and taxes, we've all heard that. So surely such a certainty would mean that we understood it. No. Grief is the most difficult thing in the world to get anybody to get their head round. There are lots of reasons for that, that stiff upper lip British mentality we sometimes have. Maybe it's the culture that we've been raised in, lack of talking, lack of sharing, fear. But here's something. Every loss is as unique and different as both the person who has died and the person who loved them. Let me say that to you again. Every loss is as unique and different as the person who died and the person who loved them. In other words, each one of you here tonight, even if you've lost the same person, you will feel it differently. No hug can replace their embrace. No person can substitute for their absence under the twinkly lights of a Christmas tree or when it's your turn to walk down the aisle. Nobody can substitute for that arm. Maybe it's just very simple, like missing your weekly breakfast catch-up at a local cafe, or maybe it's the way they dance to a certain song, or the way they partied, or just their general carry-on. The person you loved so much is utterly irreplaceable. So many that I asked, in fact, I think everybody, talked with aching, and I mean aching sorrow, about that very difficult first year. And some of you are right in the middle of that. That time when the absence of our loved one is probably most acutely felt. Is that where you are tonight? Dreading the next event on the calendar? Maybe tonight you could have the courage just to say that to somebody. Just say it out loud. I know I would love to hear it. Just say, I am really struggling. It doesn't need an answer. It doesn't need a solution. I wonder how many of you are actually feeling lonely and discouraged because people find it hard to reach out to you, to allow you that room to grieve. They struggle to say, I'm sorry, I don't understand your pain, but I'm here. Are you longing for people to understand where you're at? Remembering can be so difficult when all we feel it brings is a reminder of what is lost. That is grief. Grief is not an emotion, it's a real thing. It comes and it squeezes into that space that was once filled by our loved one. We don't choose it. We can't choose to bypass it. And as I said before, how you experience it will be unique to you. Grief is not very obedient. It doesn't conform to timescales. But as I say, every service I do here, where you are right now is where you need to be. But grief is also our soul's way of allowing us to adjust to a world without our loved one. And while you may feel lonely, overwhelmed, even enraged or confused, you're also healing. I must say too that what comforts one person might be a trigger to another. The sound of a familiar song coming on the radio might make you smile from ear to ear, but it also might make you run to the hills and feel that pain all over again. One person said to me, I hear certain songs and I feel like I've been punched in the chest. Grief is physical. We're all searching to find ways to hold on to that person. We wish that we could tell them about our achievements, our children, their children. Wondering what life would have been like, especially when a person is taken too soon, too young, too early in their foray into the big adventure that is life. Are you standing here tonight or listening tonight and are you fearful that their voice is fading from your memory? Are you just a bit lost in loneliness, but trying to paint on a face of normality? Some of what I'm saying will resonate with you. How they resonate and why is unique to you. It's so easy to compare yourself to others. How frustrating it can be to see someone else move forward if you feel stuck. Maybe you've experienced the pain of loss over and over again and you're just tired. But no matter how you feel, how overwhelmed you are, whether in person or at home, you're here. You have demonstrated the strength just by showing up. Somehow you found it, that courage to come. Maybe it was through the love of your family and friends. Maybe it's the community that you find here. Maybe it's your faith. But somewhere deep within you, you've drawn in that source to come here. Well done. Remembering that person that you loved so dearly is beautiful, even when it's painful. So as we stand here tonight, all of us with our own thoughts and emotions, my sincere prayer for all of you is that you find a way to rest in the love that you once shared, that you find courage in the experience of others, that you might feel hope. Grief does not mean you can never laugh again, nor that you cannot live life fully. Creating space in our hearts for love, life, and even laughter is one of the ways that we honour our loved one. In time, the experiences you had, the wisdom you shared, and the love between you will make its way so deeply into your soul that that terrible void that was created will be filled with your memories. We find a way to carry our loved ones with us. And here, that's a place that no illness, no disease, no violence, no misery, nothing can touch that, nothing. It's a place where we can treasure the good and leave aside the painful. It's a place that love will live on. I give my sincerest blessings to every one of you tonight, and I wish for you peace and joy, and please reach out if you need to speak to anybody. Thank you.
As long as you can.
love you. Can I just welcome John Brady, our fundraising manager, to read an epitaph to my old friend. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Margaret. Epitaph on My Own Friend by Robert Burns. An honest man here lies at rest, his ear God with his image blessed. The friend of man, the friend of truth, the friend of age and guide of youth. Few hearts like his with virtue warmed, few heads with knowledge so informed. If there's another world, he lives in bliss. If there is none, he made the best of this.
Most of you will know Sister Catherine, who's now going to lead us in prayer.
And so we pray. God, we thank you for the blessings and joy of family and friends. Thank you for those who are gathered with us today and for those who are absent. May we all see the many ways you provide for us, comfort us and protect us. We come before you, O God, to offer our prayer and thanksgiving. We thank you for the many blessings, and we ask that you continue to guide us along the way to the path that you have set before us. We ask for wisdom and knowledge as we face the challenges of life, and we seek your strength and courage to overcome all obstacles. We pray for your guidance and protection as we strive to be your presence in the world and to all whom we meet. This we ask in your name. Amen.
Our Chief Executive, Joy Farquharson, would like to express some words of thanks.
Thank you, Margaret, and thank you to everyone who has attended this evening, both in person and online. It's so lovely to see everyone and for us to have this opportunity to reflect and be thankful for the lives of those who have died over the last 12 months, but for some people, those who we have lost in previous years. I was reflecting prior to this evening's service of those loved ones whom I have lost, but their memory still plays a significant influence in my life today and drives my commitment to ensure St Andrew's Hospice is able to support the community of Lanarkshire at some of the most difficult times in their lives. The care and compassion that St Andrew's Hospice is known for and loved for cannot happen without the practical and financial support from you, the communities and businesses of Lanarkshire, which the hospice forms part of. The last 12 months has been another challenging year for everybody, including the hospice, but the community especially. Despite that, you, the people of Lanarkshire, have again supported the work here. Whether that is in supporting this campaign or others, in participating in one of our events, or holding your own tea parties or sponsored walks or head shavings. I am so thankful and grateful for the people in the community of Lanarkshire who continue to support the hospice and the work we do within the community. I'm thankful for the Sisters of Charity who in 1986 had the vision to establish St Andrew's Hospice on this site. Their faith and belief laid the foundation for us to build on for the last 37 years. I'm thankful for all our staff. They continue to be committed to their role and the ethos and the core value of the hospice and reflect it in their daily role. I'm thankful and indebted to all our volunteers, nearly 650 of them. Without them in their various roles across the organisation, we would not be able to deliver the services we do. The businesses and organisations across Lanarkshire who have supported us for years and have continued to support us over the last 12 months. Whether like Tyrrells of Burnbank and Barrett Homes in sponsoring events such as this, or in providing volunteers to underdo practical support, our fence has recently been painted by a group of volunteers. I'm thankful to all the individuals, families, schools and groups who again have supported in some amazing ways and imaginative ways over this last 12 months. The schools especially, the pupils, the teachers, the parents have made an outstanding contribution. However, most of all, what I'm thankful for are the patients that we care for and their families, for trusting us to care for them, for what as many as the most challenging and emotional period in their life. It is our privilege. Melody Beattie, an American author, sums it up when she says, "Gratitude makes sense of our past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow." The Thanksgiving thistles planted here this evening, and also the ones that have been sent out to people at home, symbolise the very best of Lanarkshire and of Scotland. The people we have loved and lost, the care that has been given, and the contribution the community continues to provide to make sure this is possible. On behalf of the trustees, all the staff, volunteers, and most of all, the patients and families that we care for, thank you.
We would really like to thank you all for joining us tonight for our Thanksgiving Thistle service, both here and via the live stream. A huge thank you to everybody involved, and there's a list and the back of your programme of all the people who have been involved and helped us out. We simply could not provide the invaluable support that we do without you. Thank you. And can I ask you as a favour to be patient while our volunteers collect all the thistles in? And then you'll be able to collect them. There's tables down on the right-hand side at the bottom of the car park here. The volunteers will guide you. And we also have water and shortbread at the side. Thank you very much indeed. And we'll now have our piper, Greg. Please feel free to help yourself to water and shortbread and to go and collect your thistles from the tables just at the back. Thank you. If you want to speak to any of us, we'll be around for a while, so please stay and say hello. Thank you.